gamers were still buying Lara Croft's adventures by the jeeploads in 2001. But critics and fans agreed, the series was losing its luster. With the release of the PlayStation 2, the Tomb Raider team decided to overhaul the game for next-generation consoles quickly.
The consensus was, it needs to change. She needs to be able to talk to people, she needs to be harder edge, she's this, I mean, this whole list of stuff, which we all sat around and, yeah, you know, we all bought into. But as that project went on, it was obvious we'd made it too big, and what we were trying to do was insane. I mean, just mad.
The time limit wasn't really enough. The team size wasn't enough. Missed loads of deadlines. Angel Knight is forced out before it's really ready.
In late 2003, the ambitious Tomb Raider, The Angel of Darkness, was released worldwide, with some mixed results. Initial sales were strong thanks to an aggressive ad campaign, but critically, the game received lower scores for its glitchy graphics and awkward control scheme.
I don't think you'd ever get anybody else to admit to Angel of Darkness that it was their fault. Ultimately, it was my fault, and I paid for that with my job, which I'm very happy about that. But it was done by committee, so you live or die by the sword.
At the same time, players were migrating to newer action-adventure games. After The Angel of Darkness, Eidos made a tough decision.
Stop. We're going to have to take this away. We've got to put this on. Jewel in the Crown franchise, we've got to... They seemed to be making a new start, so they took it over and gave it to the Crystal Dynamics in the States.
In order to creatively jumpstart the series, developers at Crystal Dynamics knew they would have to make some big changes for Eidos, while staying true to the series' roots.
Coming back and starting to work on Tomb Raider Legend posed a number of challenges, because one of the biggest questions that were asked was, is the franchise still alive today? Is the consumer interested?
An old friend jumped in to help answer those questions. Toby Gard, wiser from the experience of a decade earlier. Gard wanted to rekindle an old flame.
I wanted to get back involved because I felt like I could help to sort of guide the brand and guide Lara back in a sort of direction that I thought that the original Tomb Raider was taking it.
With Toby's help, developers started the difficult task of reinventing the series. The overhaul began with the leading lady herself. For the newest game, the buxom booty hunter received a full body change.
I decided to sort of turn it on its head, how we were looking, approaching the character design, which was to keep very, very caricatured proportions and shape, but then go for real realism in terms of muscle and bone structure and detail.
Next up, Crystal Dynamics made Lara's actions much more fluid, allowing killer combinations of moves. Like a pro gymnast, Lara could run, jump, and flip through Legend's intricate tombs. The new environments were a huge draw for longtime fans. In April of 2006, Eidos released Tomb Raider Legend. In the opening scene, 9-year-old Lara was traveling with her mother when the plane crash-landed in the Himalayas. The Crofts stumbled on an ancient artifact, and Lara's mother accidentally got sucked into a bizarre time rift.
The concept is this plane crash that she suffered at a young age in the Himalayas and having to escape on her own, breaking her out of this sort of cozy lifestyle.
Critics loved the revamped control scheme and called it a true return to the series' roots. The changes paid off. Legend sold over 3 million copies worldwide, becoming the fastest-selling Tomb Raider game ever. Thanks to the daring facelift, the Tomb Raider series was back on track, and fans couldn't be happier.
We've just really scratched the surface of what you can do with Tomb Raider up until now, and so the future going, it's just going to hold so much more.